Francis Tibet and a full talk about blast preparation within a storm at the
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you to the organizers for organizing all these very nice events. So today I would like to report some work I did with Miguel Rodriguez, who is in Rennes. And it concerns the Vlasov equation, mostly the linear equation, where we apply a strong external magnetic field. So the outline of the talk is the following. First, I will very briefly present the physical context and the different problems we want to solve. And then I will... You see where it's okay?
It's
okay. So I will review the two different results. The one by François Goltz and Laure Saint-Raymond, and later Laure Saint-Raymond, on the gyrokinetic limit of a simplified Vlasov equation. And another proof which has been recently proposed by Evelyn Mio, where she used a different approach, and it has the approach with Miguel has the same flavor. Then here I will be interested mainly in a strategy in order to solve nonlinear and complex problems. So I will briefly present the main ingredient of the proof and try to convince you that maybe it's possible to adapt this strategy to nonlinear problems. Okay? And then, at the end, I will present, without any proof, the result we have in the general case and in the 3D case. And finally, instead of a proof, maybe pictures are sometimes more expressive, yes. I would say relevant, but no. And so I will show you some very simple numerical simulation on the 3D case in order to explain what we have done. So the physical problem and previous results. So the physical context is the following. We are interested by the Vlasov equation with a strong external magnetic field. We have in mind two different applications. The first one is about magnetic fusion confinement. So, for instance, there is this tokamak machine built in ICOL-ITER, which is an international program. And the machine is should be built, I don't know, with built in Cadarache, in France. And actually, there is exactly the same kind of machine which is also built in a national program in China, in the city of Hefei. And there is another context, which is the Stellarator. And this machine is built in Greifswald. Okay. I think it's in East Germany. Correct? Yeah. Okay. And so just to give you some examples, so here this is a picture of a tokamak. So the idea is to put a plasma inside and to confine this plasma using external coils that you can see around the torus. So it is in ITER. They expect to build 18 of these coil in order to confine the plasma. Just to give you an idea, the temperature in the tokamak is about 150 millions of degrees compared to the temperature of the center of the sun, which is 15 million of degrees. So inside the tokamak, the temperature will be 10 times larger than in the sun. Of course, the physics is different since the sun is very dense, whereas in the plasma, we are in the case of a very low density. The second application concerns Earth magnetic field, sorry. And so it can help us, for instance, to since it protects us from the solar wind and allowing to put some radioactivity on the Earth. About the stellarator, I forgot to say that this is more or less the same idea of the tokamak, except that the magnetic field or the device is much more complicated. It's a kind of helicoidal. And the idea is that the plasma is perfectly well confined. The particle, the magnetic field lines are very smooth compared to the magnetic field line generated by this device, where you see a line, for instance, here in black. And so it's not very smooth, and there is really a difficulty to confine the plasma. Whereas with the stellarator, the main difficulty is to produce the current itself. And once it's done, they expect that the plasma is well confined. Okay, so the mathematical model that we may consider for that is the Vlasov equation without any collisions. Here, it's, as it was explained this morning by Sacha, we can forget the collisions since here we are in a different frame for low density and high temperature. But we have a multi-species plasma, so alpha may represent both ions and electrons. Electrons are lighter, so they are faster than ions. And we suppose that the external magnetic field is very intense. So to compute the electric field, we suppose that it comes from a potential phi, which is solution to the Poisson equation as it is written here. So I will not detail all the different scaling we can have. Here, I just want to emphasize two different frequencies. The first one is the plasma frequency, which is given by this quantity for one species, okay? And from that, as we have seen this morning, we can define the d by length by the ratio between the thermal velocity and the plasma frequency. Here, there is another important frequency. It's called the cyclotron frequency. It corresponds to this quantity here, and it is quite large due to the intensity of the magnetic field. Then, from this time scale, we can construct another length scale, typical length. This is the Larmor radius, which corresponds to the ratio between the thermal velocity and the cyclotron frequency. And here, the small parameter, epsilon, will be the ratio between these two frequencies. It is expected that it is small. Okay, so this is the model we would like to solve. Unfortunately, it's almost impossible. First, due to the fact that this is really a multi-scale problem, due to the strong gradients generated by the, for instance, in the tokamak, in temperature, for instance, but also to the fact that the magnetic field is intense. And we have different species with different mass. So we may have many parameters, and a lot of them are small, but not completely negligible. So in physics, usually we solve the equation for ions. Okay, so we assume that the scale we want to observe is the one given by the motion of ions. And so electrons are supposed to be very fast. So here, they are supposed to be at thermal equilibrium. So we just compute a macroscopic equation for the electrons, and the coupling is performed thanks to the equation on the electric field, the Poisson equation, for instance. There is another approach, which corresponds to drift kinetic model, where here, we average the fast motion of particles along the magnetic field lines. So we do not solve them. And we consider that the limit when the lap the Larmor radius goes to zero. But sometimes it's not enough precise, so we can consider also the finite Larmor approximation, and it corresponds to the gyrokinetic model. Okay, so we can find all this zoology of models in the literature. For instance, I refer to the work by Little John, a series of work in order to derive from the physical point of view gyrokinetic and drift kinetic models. But here it's quite difficult to identify what are the small parameters and why some terms are negligible or not. And this work continues after Little John by Brizard, Scott, and also Morita. So from the mathematical point of view, there are very few works devoted to a general geometry or a general magnetic field. So we can split the work between the ones where we consider nonlinear problems, and in that case, the magnetic field is quite simple. It's what we will see in the following. Whereas when we consider general magnetic field, in that case, it's difficult to treat nonlinear terms. So people consider linear equations. So the work I would like to review today are the following. Here, we consider the simplest magnetic field we can. So it acts only in the z direction, and it is constant. So it means that we ignore variation of the magnetic field in time and space. We also ignore a curvature effect. And in that case, there is a nice decoupling between what happens in the perpendicular direction to the magnetic field and in the parallel direction of the magnetic field. So the advantage is by doing this, we can follow the study the long-time behavior of the solution. So here we change the time scale and consider we change t in epsilon t, that is, we consider the long-time behavior. So the equation that I want to consider from the distribution function of ions, let us say, f epsilon, is solution to this equation. So if you recognize the transport equation with an epsilon in front of the time derivative because of the change of time scale. And here, the electric field is solution to the Poisson equation, whereas the magnetic field is only given by this, where the operator PERT, it's just a rotation of pi over 2, okay, in the xy plane. And we put a 1 over epsilon just to say that this magnetic field is intense. Okay, perfect. And then from this, we can compute the macroscopic quantities, for instance, the charge density rho epsilon, which corresponds to the integral of f epsilon with respect to v. Okay, and this is the result given by Laure Saint-Raymond in this paper in 2002. So she considers a weak solution to the Vlasov-Poisson equation with a finite energy. And we assume that these quantities are uniformly bounded with respect to epsilon. Okay? So it means that the L infinity norm may blow up, but like 1 over epsilon. Then we define the density, rho epsilon, and in the limit, so it is a weak limit, so according to Sacha, it's not really a limit, but this is the result, which has been proven. In the limit, rho epsilon converges to rho, where rho is solution to this equation. So this is called the guiding center equation. And for people who are more familiar with the fluid mechanics, we can recognize here the incompressible Euler equation in vorticity forms. Okay. So it allows to make the link between Vlasov-Poisson with an external magnetic field and the incompressible Euler equation. Okay. It's just the idea of the proof here. Where I put it. So So the idea is simple. We are not interested by the limit of the distribution function itself, but on the density for epsilon. So we just start from the about a priori estimate here. So you see this term is the microscopic field is divergence free. So this equation is incompressible, and so we have conservation of LP norm, for instance. So it means that F epsilon LP is bounded if initially this quantity is bounded. Okay, and we also have defined the energy, and if initially this energy is bounded, then for all time, E epsilon of T is smaller than E epsilon of zero, which is smaller than a constant. So it gives us some a priori estimate on the distribution function, and we can expect to pass to the limit. So there is no problem to pass to the limit in linear terms, except that there is a nonlinear one due to the coupling with Poisson equation. But it's not really a problem. It's exactly the same compactness result as we have for to prove existence of solution for the Vlasov-Poisson equation. We can get more or less strong compactness on the electric field and weak compactness on F epsilon. But here, so formally, F epsilon should converge in a weak sense, in a sense of measure, to a distribution function, and epsilon goes to zero, which depends on T, X, and the modulus of V. Since due to the fast gyration of the particles, we consider that the solution becomes isotropic in velocity, and the angular velocity goes to zero. If we formally multiply this equation by epsilon, we get that V perp times the gradient of F epsilon is equal to zero. It means that the...
But you don't have also a strong solution in the sense of Pfaffelmoser.
So it's difficult because we cannot... Because of the long-time behavior. There is an epsilon in front of the time derivative, so all the estimates on the gradient, they will blow it. So we cannot consider, this later. Okay. So anyway, we compute the time evolution for the, we define the J epsilon, which is the current, F epsilon V dV, and we compute the equation for epsilon. From the continuity equation, we have this. And then we multiply again the equation for the current J epsilon, and we get, I put epsilon here, epsilon dt J epsilon plus the divergence in X of F epsilon V cross V dv is equal, so here we perform an integration by part against V, and we get rho epsilon E epsilon minus J epsilon per over epsilon. Okay, so the idea now is to take the perp of this term. Okay, I do that. So we take perp of perp, it's a rotation of minus pi. So I change the sign here and I remove this term. Here we get a perp. Here I can put the perp here. And J epsilon here. And then, okay, we divide by epsilon this term. And then we substitute J epsilon in this equation here. So finally, we get an equation for rho epsilon plus divergence in X of epsilon dt J epsilon plus the divergence in X of F epsilon V cross V dV minus rho epsilon E epsilon. Yep, I forgot perp everywhere. Equal to zero. Okay, so to pass to the limit here, there is no difficulty on this linear term here. Here we have enough compactness as the for existence of solution. The bad term is this one. because we just have energy estimate. We don't, since we are limited to the long-term behavior, we cannot get estimate on the on this for higher-order moments. And so it's difficult to pass to the limit in this term. Okay, so what is the idea of this paper in Laure Saint-Raymond? Is to work with to introduce a truncated density, rho r epsilon, which corresponds to of f epsilon dv d smaller than r. And then we can find an equation. I will not write it. We find an equation for this quantity, okay? And then we choose r according to epsilon in order to pass to the limit, okay? And then we can treat this term and recover the limit equation for the, that we have. Okay, now I'm in trouble. Okay, perfect. So this is the result. Okay. There is a recent work by Emeline Niau, which is still, this work is still, this paper is still unpublished, as far as I know. And so here, the interesting approach, I think, is that she works at the level of the characteristics. So she considers F epsilon, which are smooth solutions and compatibly supported, not uniformly with respect to epsilon. But for this, for F epsilon, we can define the characteristic curves and pass to the limit. Okay? And so what is the key point in her proof? That she introduced, this is Laure Saint-Raymond and the proof of Emeline Niau. It follows actually an idea of a paper of Maxime Auré and Nourri and Philippe Viendry in KRM, I think, where they compute they treat the similar problem. But here, she introduces a new distribution function, f epsilon bar of TXV, which is f epsilon of TX minus epsilon V perp V. And then, she defines rho epsilon bar of TX as the integral of f bar epsilon TX. Give you the idea why it's interesting to do that. We will see that this here, this variable, let us call it Y, it corresponds in physics to the guiding center, and it satisfies at the level of the characteristic curve a very nice equation.
Now, excuse me, there is no T in front of the orthogonal. I mean, it's not particle going around.
No, it's a Eulerian point of view. No. Epsilon V perp.
So it's fixed.
Yeah, it's the level of variables.
No, because there means that you are going around the average.
So it's just, you can see just as a change of variable.
It's a change of variable.
Okay. And let me show you why this level, this change of variable is interesting. So actually, in these notes, she proposed two proofs. The one is just based on the Lagrange, on the characteristic curves, and the new one is the Eulerian point of view, playing with these quantities. Okay, so they are separated. So just it's just to compare this quantity with the one that was studied by Laure. But here, let me just perform a very simple computation to show you why this variable here is important. So you consider the characteristic curve, and you write the equation on V. This is the bad variable. You want to remove it. Minus V perp over epsilon. So you how to do that. Okay, you take again the perp. You change the plus here and V perp. And then you just play with the you have a, and you write the equation on X as dxdt equal to v over epsilon. So the idea is just to combine these two equations, v over of x minus epsilon v per, and you find an equation, you remove the fast scale, and you just get minus e per of t of x. You can write it, if you want, as y plus epsilon v per. And you see that when you work with this variable, you have removed the fast scale, and it's quite easy to pass at the limit, to pass to the limit, sorry, as far as you have a control on the velocities. Okay? So, and actually, I think it's very clever to do that, and actually we did it with Miguel independently. So it's, to design, so in, with the different different purpose is to construct numerical schemes for this kind of equation. Perfect. Here, wait. Okay, I have to remember what I want to say. Okay, so, yes. Other works. Yeah, so here the I will not be interested by the results themselves, but by the proof, and because I would like to adapt later the strategy to a more complicated problem. So here I would like just to review different approach where most of the time we ignore the nonlinear effect. So there is a point of view developed by physicists where they are really interested by the Hamiltonian structure of the system, and they perform some expansion of the Hamiltonian, and at each level they want to preserve this Hamiltonian. So okay, so for us it seems that it's quite difficult to exploit this approach for this simple problem. There is another approach by Posaner, which recently a work like this. This is the Lagrangian approach, where he worked with the variational formulation of the characteristic curves. There is another approach developed by Freno and Sonnendrucker, where they apply a homogeneization techniques for transport equations. But here it's quite difficult to recognize an equation in the limit. And there are also techniques by Mihai Bostan on where he filters fast oscillations. So here, we would like to treat a very general case for a general magnetic field and using a very simple method. So up to now, it allows us to capture the second order approximation of the solution and to describe the slow dynamics on short time scale, but in arbitrary geometry, that is for any magnetic field. And our frame is related to averaging of ODEs. So I refer, for instance, to the work of Bogoliubov and Mitropolsky in 61 and the book by Sanders, Verlust, and Burdock. So that is, we will work at the level of the characteristic curve and try to follow the slowest scale. So how to do that? Blah, blah, blah. The ingredient of the proof and... So here I will again consider the simple problem, not because we cannot treat the complex one, but because all the computations are simple and easier to present. So here we solve the short time scale, dx dt equal v, and dv dt is equal to e of tx minus v per over epsilon. And we multiply, just to complexify a little bit, we consider that the magnetic field depends on time and space. But this is just a scalar. Okay? In the direction does not change, just its intensity can change with respect to time and space. And V perf, again, is minus V2, V1. And so here we work in F2, in dimension 2. So it means, I mean, in the perpendicular plane to the magnetic fields. So from this, since we work on short time, it's easier than the previous case, we can control easily the trajectory of the particle. So it's bounded by x0 plus t v0 plus t square k0, where k0 is an infinity norm of the electric field, and the same for the velocity variable. Okay, where k0 corresponds to the infinity norm of the electric field. In the following, we suppose that E is a double joint free infinity, and B, 1 over B, is double joint 2 infinity. Which means that 1 over B is is bounded from below. So here we want to follow the slow scale of this equation. So how to do that? We do the same as before. I showed you. And so we keep the equation on x. And here, observe that if we multiply this equation by v, then there is a cancellation of this term, so it's not a fast scale, so it's something which is interesting for us. So v square over 2 is given by the scalar product between t of tx and v. Okay, so here we observe that if we just look on the right-hand side, it is of order 0 with respect to epsilon, and it is linear with respect to V. Okay? So the idea now is to play with the equations, and to we are need to estimate linear operator with respect to V. So we consider L of t, a linear operator, and we want to evaluate quantity of V, where V is solution to the system 1. And this is 2. Okay, so how to do that? But as before, we start again with the second equation of 2. So we write it V equal to T of Tx minus V of Tx over epsilon. So I multiply by epsilon. I take the perp operator. Perp is minus pi, and I divide by b. And here there is epsilon over b. So here. Okay, we have an expression for V, but as a small term, which is under control, and here, this term, we don't really know, since it's not an exact derivative, it's not very nice, so we will write it as an exact derivative, so it's equal to epsilon d over dt of V perf over V, plus epsilon V perp over V and the time derivative, so V square, sorry, dtb plus dx of B, and the derivative of x is V, so here there is a V, okay, of Tx, minus epsilon E perp over B is equal to V. So now we take L t of V,
So here, epsilon LT of V and LT this term. Again, this term is not an exact derivative, so we write it as an exact derivative. It's epsilon d over dt of Lt v per b minus epsilon l prime of t v per over b plus all the other terms, epsilon Lt v per over b square dt b plus dx b to b minus epsilon v per over b, and this is equal to LTV. Okay. I have to do that. I came just for that. So I gave lectures last summer in Austria. And I used this, and now I import it in France. My students are very happy. Still, I have to practice, but. So now we have an expression of Lt of V for any linear operator Lt of V. It's exactly what we have in the right-hand side. So we can replace now the expression of the linear terms with respect to V by this expression here. Okay, I give you the result. So we introduce a new variable, y, which corresponds to x minus epsilon v per over b. Okay, it's wrong what I wrote. Okay. And this is called the guiding center in physics textbook. And we find an equation for y now. Instead of the equation on x, we have now this new equation. It is given by minus epsilon e per of tx over b minus 1 over b square of v per scalar product with dtb plus dxbv. Okay. And we do the same. Instead of working with the modulus of v square over 2, we introduce omega, which is v square over 2, minus epsilon, the scalar product of p over b with v per. Okay, it's the L operator now is the scalar product of e with my variable. And this corresponds, so when I evaluate an operator Lt of V, I have a derivative which appears here, which is this one. And so it explains this variable here that we have. And the equation satisfied by omega is the omega dt is equal to minus epsilon dt of E plus dx E V V per over V plus epsilon over b square of dtb plus dxb times v, scalar product with v, and times the scalar product between e and v per. Okay. Let us have a look on these two equations. Here. We started with an equation on x and v square over 2 with terms which were
of order 0 with respect to epsilon and linear with respect to V. Now, with this change of variable, with this change of variable, we have now terms of order epsilon, only terms with respect to epsilon, but the price to pay is that we have replaced linear terms by non-linear terms, quadratic terms. So there are still terms which are constant here. Here this one is linear. We know how to evaluate linear operator with respect to V. But now we have to estimate also, you know, if we want to close this system, we have to estimate quadratic term with respect to V. And this is the same for the equation on W, or on omega. So we started with a linear equation and of order 0. Now we have an equation of order epsilon with non-linear, with quadratic terms. So what is the how to continue? We just have to apply exactly the same strategy as before. But instead of evaluating linear operators, we want to evaluate quadratic operators with respect to V. So I give you directly the result because the time is close. And so we consider A of T, an operator from F2 to F2. And we evaluate AT of VV, where V is solution to 1. Okay? And so what we find is that is equal to V square over 2, the trace of A of T, plus epsilon, the time derivative of function depending on A of T, plus another function eta A of T, which depend on A, and this function, these two functions are depends also on X and V, or V, sorry, and they are cubic with respect to V. So again, we can apply the same strategy in order to evaluate linear and quadratic terms and replace, get at the end, terms of order epsilon squared times function which depends non-linearly on in the cubic way on V, but they just depend on V. And so I remind you that we control the V variable. So it means that we have terms of order epsilon squared. Like this, we can close this, we can get, when we apply this kind of operator and evaluate linear and quadratic term, we get an equation for y of this type, d over dt of y of t plus a correction of order epsilon squared, that we will neglect it, is equal to minus epsilon e per of t y. Okay, now we Taylor expand the electric field and we replace x by y plus a remainder term of ty, and here minus epsilon b. Here this term, linear terms, does not, they only contribute at second order, but here the quadratic term has a contribution due to this result here. So we evaluate as the gradient of b per times e, correct? Sorry, no, not wrong, yeah. Times omega, the variable omega, plus some remainder term which depend on t, x, v, but which are of order 2 with respect to epsilon. And so ry, and the same for y, d over dt of omega of t, plus a remainder term. Is equal to epsilon, the divergence of E perp over B minus gradient perp of B scalar product E times B squared and times omega and plus some remainder terms of order epsilon squared.
R omega t x v,
which are all these terms are bounded. So if we integrate, then we get a slow motion for the two new variables y and w. Okay, so here, by doing this, we have found a map in order to transform our original system to a new one, which evolved slowly. Okay, and if we continue by evaluating cubic or quartic term, we can increase the order of the method. Of course, you have to do more and more computations. Okay, so this approach here can be generalized to the 3D case without any problem, except that there are tedious computations. Okay. How much time do I have? 10 minutes?
5 minutes.
5 minutes.
7 minutes.
Okay. Yes. So here, I work only at the level of the characteristic curves. Unfortunately, we want to solve a PDE, a transport equation. So the main idea is that we have here, we want to solve an initial problem with fast scale. This is our kinetic equation, the original one. And at the end, if we perform some computation as I did, we can obtain an average problem which only contains slow scales, and we have removed the fast one. So this is the equation. So we can generate two kinds of flows. The first one corresponds to the fast scale flow by solving the first problem, and the second one is by solving this equation here. Okay? Now, how to make the link between the two problems? So it's not complicated. The result that we have is the goal is to construct a time-dependent slow map which allows to pass from the original coordinate, x, v, to the slow one. It's this map, we call it calligraphic A. And the small a now is a slow variable. Okay? And so what we claim is that if we are able to have such estimate, so here we estimate on the this corresponds to the flow corresponding to the slow scale, okay, and which is initialized by the operator A at time zero in order to pass from the Y variable to the A, which corresponds to the slow variable. Here we compare it with the original flow, the fast one, but from which we apply the slow map in order to recover something which is at a slow scale. So from this quantity here, we can generate a new distribution function starting from the distribution function of solution of the original problem, the fast scale. So here, this step here corresponds to a kind of averaging of the distribution function in order to follow only the slow scales. Then we can compare this object computed from the solution to the fast scale problem with G, which is solution to the asymptotic model, the transport equation with the slow scale. Okay, and so if we have this kind of estimate on the flow, just we can get again estimate on the distribution function in the weak sense again, but we have this kind of estimate. We preserve the estimate that we had on the flow. So just to give you an example, if F epsilon is solution to the original problem, we perform this averaging here by averaging with respect to the angular velocity here. And then we have a new distribution function, F epsilon, which depends on x and, E here, it's the double loop. And we can compare F epsilon to the G epsilon, the solution of the slow scale problem. And we preserve the same kind of estimate of order epsilon. Okay. Now I will just give you the result for the general case. So we want to solve this problem. We play with the characteristic curves. And I have to go quickly. The main point here is to separate the scale between fast and slow scale. So we decompose the magnetic field as its intensity, B, times E parallel, which corresponds to a unit vector, which depends on time and X. And we define this operator here, this is the cross product. From this, we define the V parallel variable, since this variable is not affected by the magnetic field, and the V perp, which is the one which is oscillating very quickly. We do the same for the electric field. We decompose in parallel and perpendicular direction. Okay. And then we have at the end a problem like this. So it's exactly as the one in the 2D case, except that now we have the parallel direction. And but you see, again, we have linear terms with respect to V. Due to the curvature, we have quadratic terms with respect to V. Okay, we will have treat them. And here we have other terms which are again quadratic with respect to V perp, cubic, it depends. So we apply exactly the same strategy by evaluating linear operator applied to V, quadratic operator applied to V, and so on, up to quartic terms. Okay? And so what we can get, so I will just focus on the characteristic, the average velocity that we have, the macroscopic velocity. At the first order approximation, the particle follow the parallel direction of the magnetic field. And it is also influenced by the parallel direction. And other terms are coming from curvature effects. Okay? But actually, so again, by doing the same strategy as I presented to you before, we can get a first order approximation of our equation in this sense. Okay, so we compare G to F epsilon, which is this average here. Now, it's not actually enough, because here we neglect all the effect due to the E cross B or grad B drift. So we can, just a remark. In the limit, even if we didn't use it, we recover the conservation of energy of our equation, and also the conservation of adiabatic invariant, which is given by this quantity, the volume over V. So it's now we want to capture the second order asymptotic. I will not give you the detail, but what I can tell you here is that we recover all the classical drift that we found in the literature. The E cross B drift, which is given by this quantity, the curvature effect due to the curvature of the magnetic field, and also the time, there are also time variation dependence here. And there is another term, which is the grad B drift. And finally, this last term, which is due to the rotational effect on the magnetic field. So, in the limit, or in the first order approximation, we can add a new macroscopic velocity, new epsilon, which corresponds to the sum of the first order approximation plus a correction, where this correction takes into account all the classical drifts. And to finish, since I do not present the proof, I would like to show you just some simulation that we perform. If it doesn't work, it's
the problem is that I don't see. Okay,
this is the configuration that we consider. We want to confine a particle in this device, and we have a kind of helicoidal magnetic field, which has two components. A toroidal component, which corresponds to the large radius, and the poloidal component, which corresponds to the small radius here. Okay. So this is the sum of two terms. And here, I will show you the trajectory of the particle compared with which corresponds to the initial one, solving the characteristic curve of the original problem, and the trajectory corresponding to the asymptotic model, where we remove the fast scale. So, as you can see, the red one is the smooth trajectory, which corresponds to the guiding center approximation, whereas the black one corresponds to the trajectory of x in space. We are in space here. So I keep all the history of the trajectory just to show you that even for large time, we can follow quite precisely the motion of this particle. It is not true if we neglect all the correction term of order epsilon. Just because if we consider only first order terms, then the particle will stay on the magnetic field line. Whereas here, you will see that after a while there is a small drift, and it's important to capture because it can be considered as a lack of confinement. Okay, so finally, since we are at the large scale and space scale, we don't see the oscillations, but of course, there are small oscillations here around the smooth trajectory.
Zero.
Okay, so this is a pure confined. Yeah. So, except that we have the effect
of the drift. My question would be, can you start from a model like that and have some configuration that models what the physicists call a disruption, when there is a sudden field coming up? And I would like even to see if you have any intuition where that would come from.
About disruption, I don't know.
You don't know.
But here we can put.
But you can put a field and you see the drift.
It's not a problem to put the electric field, it's just because I didn't know what to put, so I set it to zero. Okay. But what is interesting?
Can you put it in Maxwell's
equation? No. Just electric and magnetic field are given, and just the Maxwell's equation. Sorry, just the last one, if you allow me. Because here we have the view at the macroscopic level. And in space, it's not so interesting because the oscillations are of order of the Larmor radius, which is of order of epsilon. In the velocity space, what happened is much more interesting. So here, this is another picture, but another movie, but in the velocity space. And I have to sit. Okay, yes. Okay, so now what I will show you is the particle trajectory in the velocity space. Okay, and I just keep only some short time scale because I want to follow the particle. So we just have the short history in the so you see it is removed after a while, the trajectory. Just to show you that here, what happens in the velocity space is much more complicated since the oscillations is of order of the thermal velocity. It's not and so we see here that it seems that the particle is oscillate around this guiding center velocity, which has a very smooth trajectory. And so here, even for large time, if we neglect all the fast scale, we are able to follow the fast motion of this particle. And you will see, if you wait a few seconds, that it will enter in a region where the intensity of the magnetic field will become larger and larger, so there will be a really fast oscillation, and even with the scheme that we use, a high order scheme for the just for one particle, for the initial problem, it's not easy to compute the solution for large time. So you see,
the discrete set is becoming this.
Yeah, so we don't see very well the oscillations, and here you see it's worse and worse, but still the two velocities, the guiding center velocity, is a good approximation where we remove all the fast oscillations, where we follow the, this is really a local error since we move with the particle. Okay, I think it's my time is over. Thank you very much. To discretize the scheme, the equation that we have, and with many particles, and indeed we have done simulations like that. The only problem is, at the theoretical point of view, to treat non-linearities. Mm-hmm. When we have a self-consistent electric field.
Does the scheme conserve kinetic energy?
No, here I don't care about.
Just the particle, okay.
But just, it's not important. It's okay. Not important because okay. The kinetic energy you have here. So if you have a good scheme for this variable, you will follow the log.
Maybe we should go up to the next problem.
Sorry? They start to